Coming to you from the University of Minnesota, Rochester, our town.
Or you can start speaking up. Nothing's gonna hurt you the way the words do when they settle near your skin.
So it's time to put those phones down while driving. I'm here with Chief Jim Franklin, who's gonna tell us a little bit more about how we can stay safe and legal while driving. Welcome to our town.
Thank you for having me.
Can you just tell us a little bit about what hands-free means?
Yeah, well, hands-free, obviously, Governor Tim Walz signed the hands-free legislation bill in April, and the law went into effect August 1st, so we're just starting that. Yep, absolutely. And hands-free means you need to put your cell phone down. And hands-free does not mean distraction-free, because there are still a plethora of distractions driving a motor vehicle, whether it's eating in the car or not paying attention. So we really want motorists to understand that it's so important for them to really pay attention to their surroundings, have that situational awareness, put down the distractions, and focus on driving for the motoring public safety.
So the focus is really about the phones, but you want the public to be really aware of all the other things that might be causing the sandwich, the coffee, the, you know, batting the kid in the back seat.
Absolutely, and most of us don't multitask very well. So sure. Yeah, we're asking the public to put those things down, including, and most importantly, the cell phones.
So what is law enforcement looking for now with, you know, what are you looking for when you're seeing motorists out there on the street now?
Yeah, well, we started with a pretty heavy emphasis on the education piece before the law went into effect, trying to educate the motoring public about this is a new law and you have to abide by that, and it is time to put your cell phones down and go hands-free. But what we're looking for now is, distracted driving, weaving, crossing over the center lines, crossing over the white lines, and actually looking for people with cell phones in their hands and up to their ears.
So what is then permissible? So we know what not to do. What can we do? Can we use the GPS? Can we use the phone at a stoplight? Some of these other things.
Yeah, so the hands-free legislation doesn't mean that you cannot use a cell phone in a motor vehicle. It just needs to be, can't be in your hand. So it needs to either be mounted or voice activated. So the message piece is either use the voice activation piece, you know, and with Siri or Hey Siri, call this person, or use kind of a one-touch phone system there.
That's built into your
activation.
Phone.
Yeah, one-touch activation.
Okay,
yeah.
Got it.
For making those calls, yes.
And talk to me a little bit about earbuds. So I've heard some stories that you can't have earbuds in both ears.
Yeah.
How are people supposed to use the earbuds properly to stay safe?
Yeah, so I mean, hearing is an important part of driving and kind of that situational awareness piece. So yeah, we do highly encourage using earbuds with this new legislation. And if you're gonna do that, you can only have the earbud in one ear or the other. It should not be in both, as that kind of impairs your hearing and your awareness as well.
Sure. So how's law enforcement gonna be handling the enforcement of this new law? What are kind of the steps that you're gonna be taking? Is it gonna be tickets, warnings? What is that gonna look like for people?
It'll involve all of that. Obviously, again, we started out with this educational campaign, significantly trying to encourage the public and educate the public on the new law here, and enforcement is a part of the process as well. From the Rochester Police Department perspective, we're starting out, we've done a lot of traffic stops focusing on distracted driving in the last couple of weeks as this new law focused on the education piece and on the front end.
So making sure everyone's aware so they don't make those make some illegal choices.
Absolutely.
Moving forward. This legislation came down, because we were talking about some really serious numbers around fatalities that were happening across the state. Can you talk to us a little bit about some of those numbers?
Yeah, well, of the states, and I believe Minnesota is the 20th state to enact similar legislation here, hands-free legislation, I believe 12 of those states have actually collected data on it, and they've actually seen a 15% decrease in fatalities since enacting the legislation. Within the state of Minnesota alone, if you take the period from 2014 to about 2018, preliminary data attributes about 60,000 crashes to distracted driving. So it is definitely a significant issue. And then if you just take the issue of texting while driving, which is extremely dangerous, in the state of Minnesota, we've seen a 30% uptick from 2017 to 2018 in just citations issued. And to put it into context, roughly about 7,500 citations in 2017, upwards of just shy of 10,000 citations just for texting for driving, which again signifies that we need to put our phones down.
Definitely, and that's such a, texting is a big part of all our lives. I think that makes me also think a lot about youth and young adults that are on the road for the first time. Are you doing any special education around just that whole piece of texting and driving and then, you know, putting your phone down?
Yeah, we're reaching out to the youth as well. I have a 15-year-old daughter that just got her permit, so there is a lot of in-house education going on, I'll tell you that. But no, we are reaching out, going to use the start of the school year as an opportunity to kind of reach some of the high schoolers that are starting the new school year, again, trying to get in front of the issue.
And when somebody does get a citation or, you know, gets involved with law enforcement around having their phone in hand, would that be considered a primary offense? What will that be considered when people...
It's a moving violation.
Okay. We just want to know the legalities of that for those legal nerds out there. How can people, community members, get connected with more information, find out more about the legislation? And what can they do if maybe they see, if you see someone, you know, using their phone? What are some steps they might take?
Yeah, so if the public wants more information, there's a lot of information, great information about what's allowed, what's not allowed, and different things that they can do to make their vehicle more accessible to still be able to make phone calls inside the vehicle. At the Department of Public Safety website, the DPS website for the state of Minnesota, and then also you can go to handsfreemn.org for some information on exactly what's allowable and what's not allowable, and general information about the new law itself.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for joining us, Chief Franklin, and thanks so much for educating the public.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thank you, Nicole.
Is brought to you in part by the following amazing people and organizations.
Clemens Chevrolet proudly partners with award-winning KSMQ Public Television. Clemens Chevrolet in Rochester. Clemens' clear value promise is to make buying a car fast, fair, and simple. The Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and the citizens of Minnesota.
And the members of KSMQ Public Television. Thank you.
Be sure to stick around. We've got more great stories coming up on Our Town. First, we hit the streets with Danielle Teal on Thursday's Downtown, and we learn about a new program that's just broken ground. But first, we talk about Chicano identity, trauma, and resilience with Bobby Marinas in this week's Our Culture segment. So your current body of work, actually, we're sitting right in the middle of it, which is such a beautiful opportunity. And so it's part of the Mental Health Mind Matters project. So I was wondering if you could talk to us a little bit about let's just walk us a little bit through the work. I think it's such a unique opportunity to do that since you're here. And then I'll tack on a second question, which is, I think oftentimes we don't get to talk about that intersection of race and mental health and the impact of racism and discrimination and systemic oppression and all of that stuff and how it impacts our mental health. Mm-hmm. And just kind of thinking about your own journey with mental health and your identity and kind of what that's meant to you.
My stuff, I think, is political, like, by default sometimes, like, most of the time, without even trying. Like, mental health or poverty or domestic violence or whatever, I feel like those are, like, things that we all can relate to. I found myself with nothing to do and no commissions to paint. I had unplugged from everything, and I sat there, and I'm like, what do I really... And I had been experimenting for years with art, you know, and there would be pop-up shows, so I'd go based off a theme. But I'm like, okay, what do I want to create just to create? What do I want to explore just to explore it for myself? And I found this box of photos, and I just started, reinterpreting every single one just as fast as I could. It started with the yellow ones. It was really a photo album from, like, Salvation Army or something, so I ripped off the plastic and all that. And I just started using that as the paper. So I was creating a photo album, but in my own way. And I started to use a lot of symbolism. And things that started to come up were just really, really personal themes. like this piece right here, this, now we're talking about poverty, you know? And these are each one of these is just saturated with different meanings, you know? But this one is poverty. So this is like one of the saddest pictures I own. It's of my little sister, and it was on picture day. And her clothes sags really bad, and her jeans are just frayed at the edges, and her shoes are really dirty. But what I wanted to do is make that poverty feel overwhelming. And I wanted to really exaggerate that. And yeah, when we talk about mental health, it's like, that's one of the biggest questions. It's like, okay, well, what did this do to us? What is this? You know, there's still talks I have with my sister and my brothers and my cousins. And like, you know that the things that we all went through and the way we were raised left some residue there. So I think when it comes to race and mental health, one of the weirdest things is that we have, in our community, we have that stigma. Like, you can't go see a psychiatrist. You can't even talk about being like having anxiety or depression or none of that. So right off top, you have to suppress that. You have to hold it in. And you're not cool if you talk about anything like that or just seem soft. So I was a teenager, my dad got out of prison. And the first thing I had to do was turn that off. Like, I was raised with my mom when we were younger. You know, with that compassionate energy and more loving and everything. And then when my dad got out and I moved in with him, switched to a more masculine, like hyper masculinity, like hide all that, like buck up, like boom. So I had to hide all that. So we couldn't talk about mental health. We couldn't talk about the effects of mental health. We just had to live with it and store it. And I feel like in society or in our communities, I feel like that's one of the biggest problems, the fact that we still hold that as a stigma, you know, it's still taboo. But yeah, that's kind of where I'm at with that.
For more information about this story and other Our Town features, connect with us on Facebook, Twitter at KSMQ hashtag Our Town, or KSMQ.org/Our Town. I got pride I could roll up for miles in front of me. I don't need your help, and I don't need sympathy. I don't need you to lower the bar for me. I know I'm superwoman, I know I'm strong. I know I've got this cause I've had it all along.
As a companion piece to my conversation with Bobby and the art exhibit, the Rochester Arts Center is hosting a film screening of The Ripple Effect, Suicide Awareness, on Wednesday, August 14th from 6 to 8 p.m. The film focuses on the devastating effects of suicide and the tremendous positive ripple effects of advocacy, inspiration, and hope that are helping millions heal and stay alive. Community coordinator Josh Jensen will lead a discussion following the film. Tickets are $5 or it's free if you're a RAC member. More information can be found at rochesterartcenter.org. And did you know that you can develop film with coffee? Rick Swanson is a chemist, educator, and self-taught photographer. His current exhibit, Light Chasers, is on display at Castle Community through September 15th. With the technique of developing film, while the technique of developing film with coffee is fairly well established, he still finds a bit of mystery in the process. Check out the results Monday through Saturday from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. and Sundays from 12 to 4. All details can be found at castlecommunity.org. And if you have not yet discovered the gem that is Foster Aaron Park, August 17th is a good day for your first visit. Foster Fest is being held Saturday, August 17th at noon. This free summer music festival runs all day and it includes local vendors, foods, and tons of games for kids. Pets are also welcome outside in the beach area. Find out everything you need to know on their Facebook page at Foster Fest Rochester, MN. And I'm certain that you've noticed those new scooters cruising around town for the last week. This new mode of micromobility joins bike sharing as part of the city's grander vision. The Lime Scooter pilot launched August 1st with the city's blessing, and it's been quite a hit. If you take one for a spin, please keep the rules of the roads in mind, so no riding on the sidewalks, and a helmet is always a good idea. The pilot will run until November 30th. To find a scooter, visit li.me. Next week, we have Danielle's report from her first ride. But this week, we find out about Danielle's experience at Rochester's Thursdays Downtown in our Walkabout segment.
This is Danielle Teal with Our Town Walkabout. I'm downtown on location at Thursdays Downtown, where there's something for everyone, adults and kids. and we're going to go have a chat with a balloon guide.
I'm Houzini from Giggle Givers.
Did you know that he's not wearing matching shoes? He's making the balloon for you? What is he making? You don't know? Do you come here on every Thursdays downtown?
Not every Thursday, but a lot of them.
And you mostly do balloons?
Balloons and juggle, sometimes a little magic.
Okay, do you tell jokes too?
I don't know any jokes, but I know the best way to hide an elephant.
How?
You hide him in a cherry tree.
You do?
Yeah, have you ever seen an elephant in a cherry tree?
Never.
See?
I'm the events manager at Rochester Downtown Alliance, Monica Copet. I'm brand new. I've only been here for about a month and a half.
What makes people come downtown for Thursdays all the time?
I mean, it's a lot of fun. All the food vendors, all the awesome artisan handcrafted goods you can buy. The bands are amazing. I was rocking out while I was rolling garbages around.
I was totally rocking out too.
Yeah. The thing that touches my heart the most is the Mayo Clinic patients, because whatever they have going on, they get to take their minds off of it, even if for an hour. And that's what really touches me, and I'm glad that we can give back in that way. Yeah. So
that's awesome. Welcome to Rochester.
Thank you. I love it. I love it already.
Great.
It's home already. So
I'm so glad.
Yeah.
Do you mind if we ask you a question real quick? What makes you come to Thursdays Downtown?
The people.
Aww.
And the food.
The food is so good, isn't it?
The food is good, yes.
What makes you come downtown?
First time.
Oh, it's your first time. Awesome. Are you having fun?
I'm having a blast.
Great. Thanks, ladies.
Thank you.
If you want to dance, come on over. This is Danielle Teal with Our Town Walkabout.
Intergenerational poverty is a hard cycle to break, and mothers and children are often the most vulnerable. The JoMarie program, a national leader in disrupting the cycle in cities across the country, has set its sights on Rochester. Make it one of seven cities, including New York City, Boston, Austin, Texas, the Twin Cities, and Fargo-Moorhead. Executive Director of the new Rochester-based program, JoMarie Morris, joins us today to tell us more. Welcome to Our Town.
Thanks so much, Nicole. Thanks for having me and for the opportunity to tell the community and folks in our community about JoMarie programs.
Certainly. So what is the need for a program like this here in Rochester?
I think people would be surprised to know the high level of poverty. In Olmsted County alone, we have 39.7% of single moms with children under the age of five living in poverty. That's a really high number and the highest number of folks living in poverty.
And how many women are you hoping to get into the program or have already slated for the program?
So great question. So well, our full capacity on the campus will be 40 families. Right now, we've had 12 women that have completed empowerment and are getting ready to move onto the campus when it's open. We have another 15 women that will be starting empowerment, which is a first part of the program, in September, and more on the wait list that will start in January of 2020.
We'll get back to that, what that empowerment piece means, but can you tell us a little bit about what intergenerational poverty means in the context of your program?
Sure. Well, intergenerational poverty really means it's a situation when a family has been in poverty for more than two generations, and many, many of our families have that circumstance.
And what does that look like for people individually, as families?
Yeah, so there's several things. It's really kind of a dynamic, complex situation, but it's lack of access to education and educational opportunities, lack of role modeling, lack of community support that really lands these families in poverty generation after generation.
And what are those barriers that are keeping them from escaping that poverty?
A lot of what I've just talked about, one of the things that JoMarie does is really remove those barriers. The five pillars of JoMarie program are really to provide safe, affordable housing, which is a barrier, on-site early childhood education for their children so their children are safe, support for the women to get a career track college education, life skills and empowerment training, and really wrapping that in a community of support, which is what our founder would say really is the secret sauce of JoMarie program.
And so that's what's making it so sustainable for the families and that you work with.
That's exactly right.
So what are the main components of the program? Can you walk us through those? What a family might expect as they go through the program?
Sure. And I just explained what the pillars are, but how the program works is first, a woman will express their interest and start a 16-week empowerment program. And that's really where we do a cognitive restructuring for the women to really help them understand that this is something that they can do, but also then walk through the expectations for them in the program. JoMarie program is a really tough program. I mean, we remove the barriers, but the women work really hard. They have to be obtaining their college degree. They have to be working or volunteering part-time. Their children have to go to the Child Development Center. So there's a lot of requirements for the program. So we want to make sure the women are ready for that. If they might not be ready, we might refer them to other supports to stabilize them till they are ready to move into the program.
And so what might not readiness look like, unreadiness look like?
You know, it could be, so I'll give you an example of this. One of the many partnerships in the community we're really excited about is working with the women's shelter. So the women's shelter really works with women to stabilize them after they've been in a domestic violence situation. And they're in this transitional housing, many of them, for a period of time. Mm-hmm. Once they're stabilized, then they're ready to move on to something like JoMarie program. But sometimes they're not going to be ready. So we might do a referral to the women's shelter or another group. It could be chemical dependency issues. It could be a mental health issue. We want to make sure that the families are stabilized and getting the support they need and they're ready to move through the program.
And do you help women in terms, you mentioned college degrees, pursuing a college degree, job or volunteer opportunities, do you help connect them to those opportunities while they're in the program?
Absolutely, we do. And we just talked about women that might not be ready. So sometimes we'll get a call from a woman who hadn't completed her high school degree or diploma yet. And so then we'll connect that woman to Hawthorne and Rochester Public School System and make sure that woman is getting their GED and then applying through JoMarie program. So yes, absolutely. We have really close relationships with admissions counselors for St. Mary's Universities, Winona State University, Rochester Community and Technical College, because really that's the pivot point where they really need help in making sure that they're able to enter college.
So you're really sort of looking at that whole ecosystem and integrating into the community resources that already exist.
Absolutely.
So this might seem like a very basic question, but for some people that just might not be aware, you know, why focus on single mothers and their children?
So great question. The focus, JoMarie's been in existence now for over 20 years. And the reason for focusing on single moms is because this is the highest, they have the highest rate of poverty in the country. And this has been true for many, many years. Our founder was a Catholic priest, and he got together with directors and leaders in education and business who tried to figure out what can we do to really move these women who are in generational poverty with their young children, move them forward. And they really decided education was the way to do that. And so that's really how JoMarie came about.
So you just broke ground, was it last week?
That's right.
Looks great. Can you just talk to us a little bit about what that facility, that vision for that facility is gonna look like?
First, I just have to say I'm almost pinching myself because of the amount of community support we've got. JoMarie really believes that really in order to break the cycle of poverty, we have to have cross sectors of support. So support from the business community, from government, from the faith community, all sectors to bring it together. And that's really what happened with us, with our campus. The campus will have 40 apartments. It will have a child development center on site where our partner, Families First, is gonna run Head Start and Early Head Start for all the children on our campus. We'll have life skills and empowerment classes. We'll have space for educational opportunities for the women, a community space for them. On the second and third floors where there's an apartments, there's gonna be a study room, an area for the women to study. We'll also have playgrounds at each side of the campus.
And where in Rochester will it be located?
Right north of Lourdes, okay. Right near the intersection of 19th Street Northwest and Valley High Drive Northwest.
Fantastic. And so women, how long will they stay in the program or in the center?
So great question. It really depends on what their goals are and their educational plan says. So are they going to be obtaining a two-year degree or a four-year degree? The maximum amount of time on the campus is 5 years. The average time on the campus is about 3 years right now. So about half the women are getting two-year degrees, and about half are getting four-year degrees.
And then after that, after they leave, how do you transition them to the next part of their life?
We actually spend a lot of time with that piece. So once the women complete their degrees, they can stay on the campus for an additional 6 months while they're saving up for a place to live. We work with them with career development, helping them with job placement. So we really do continue to follow them and work with them even once they complete their degree.
Fantastic. As I had mentioned at the top of the segment, this is the seventh site of the JoMarie program. Do you have shared best practices? Do you meet with the other executive directors and other sites to sort of share program progress?
Honestly, that's one thing that really led me to JoMarie that was really appealing to me, is the fact that it's been around for 20 years and there is so much collaboration and best practices about what really works. And so actually work with and meet with executive directors from across the country every two weeks along with our national leadership team.
That's right. So how can people stay involved in what's going on and continue to support as you continue to build? Because you just broke ground, but there's still a building and a center to build. So how can people stay connected?
And I can tell you, Nicole, probably one of the biggest challenges we've had, and thanks to a lot of community support, we're working through this, but just finding affordable housing for the families that are already in the program until the campus opens up. But so folks can go to the website, jeremiahprogram.org. And they can see volunteer opportunities, and they can also look at opportunities to attend our first gala, which will be October 11th at the new Hilton building. So many, many opportunities for folks to contribute to that community support of JoMarie program.
Well, we'll certainly be staying tuned to what's ahead for you and the JoMarie program. Thanks a lot for joining us today.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us today. We hope that you've learned a lot today, and make sure to take a look at some of those the information that Chief Franklin shared about hands-free legislation that just came down last week. And Down by the Riverside's featured artist this week is Cloud Cult, and we close out with their song, To the Great Unknown. From the University of Minnesota Rochester, we will see you next week on Our Town, the show about Rochester. To the great unknown.